These huge rockets are made up of four motor segments fitted with solid fuel, designed to be reused after each launch. The joints between each segment have to withstand the vast forces produced during blastoff. Each segment is sealed against the next segment with two rubber seals, called O-rings. For the rocket boosters to work, the joints have to function perfectly. Part of Roger Beaujolais' job is to make sure they do. 3 days after mission STS-51C lands, Beaujolais starts his inspection of the joints on the returned rocket booster segments. Even 20 years later, the surprise at what he found that day is still vivid in his mind.
I went around and on the first booster, I found on one of the joints, hot gas, massive amount of hot gas from propulsion had actually compromised the primary O-ring. So I thought, my God, we came within about 8 or 10 seconds of failure.
When the rocket booster sections are slotted together, the joint is sealed by two O-rings. The O-rings are designed to form a seal against the superheated rocket exhaust gases that are produced at incredible pressure during launch. The first O-ring should do the job. The second O-ring is a safety backup. Beaujolais' photos of Flight 51C's joints reveal hard evidence there is a major design flaw. He discovers that hot gas has blasted past the first ring and burned the second backup O-ring.
I instantly, in my mind, thought, oh, this has to be caused by the cold weather that preceded this launch.
Beaujolais immediately hones in on the one thing that made Flight 51C different, the temperature. Post-flight analysis showed the O-rings were 53 degrees Fahrenheit, unusually cold for a launch. The O-rings are supposed to be flexible. On launch, they squeeze and stretch to seal the gap. But on Flight 51C, the dual O-ring system malfunctioned. The primary seal did not work, and hot gas escaped. Luckily, the second O-ring caught the leak. If it hadn't, the result might have been far more dangerous. The next day, Beaujolais reports his findings to NASA. Together, NASA and Morton Thiokol conclude that the condition is not desirable, but acceptable. Shuttle launches continue. But Beaujolais and his colleagues run further tests. The results are shocking. To their surprise, they discover that the O-rings could also be ineffective, even at room temperature. Beaujolais takes his findings to his boss.
When we went to our manager, who was my boss, and told him about this, he said this material was too sensitive to release to anybody, so he kept it secret. Do you have any idea? You have any idea what that does to somebody who's trying to put flight safety first and foremost on the program, and to have a manager do that to you?
Throughout 1985, NASA has a very ambitious launch schedule. Flight 51C is the first of 9 planned launches, and the pressure is on to keep the shuttle flying. Any delays would ultimately cost money, and jobs were at stake.
They didn't want to hear, because I believe they wanted to ensure for the company they would get the follow-on contract that was in negotiations with NASA at that point in time. That contract was worth over $1 billion.
As the weeks pass, Beaujolais' frustration at the lack of action continues to eat away at him.
Bob, did you read my memo? The O-rings, Bob? I really feel there's some urgency here. Well, the erosion was pretty bad after the last flight. Right, Bob. Right. I'll leave it with you.
While Beaujolais struggles to be heard, NASA has already announced the crew for the Challenger flight, scheduled to launch in January 1986. The Challenger commander is shuttle veteran Dick Scobee. Scobee is made of the right stuff. He rose up the ranks in the Air Force to become a test pilot before joining NASA in 1978. He is a career astronaut and first flew the shuttle in 1984. The Challenger mission will be his first time as commander. His widow June remembers his excitement.
Dick came home with such joy to say, you know, they've announced the crew for Flight 51L and I'm named the commander. It was a big celebration. I think we opened a bottle of champagne that night and celebrated.
Only professional astronauts like Scobee have flown on board the shuttle. But by mid-1985, NASA is confident enough in the shuttle's safety to allow non-specialists into space. Senator Jake Garn, chair of the committee that funds NASA, and Sultan Salman, a Saudi prince, are scheduled to fly in April and June this year. NASA's message is clear. The shuttle is safe. In the future, spaceflight will be for everyone.
Well, I think everyone was eager for space flight to be more accessible for people. And they were probably too eager to make that happen. Dick was concerned. I can remember him personally saying that, you know, that we're not ready to just fly anyone into space. I mean, we still need trained astronauts to be prepared for emergencies.
The Senator and Saudi Prince flights are successful, but create little public interest. NASA wants to regenerate enthusiasm in the space program, and putting an ordinary citizen into the shuttle is their best hope. Their teacher in space competition is gaining national interest. It is 2 months since Krista McAuliffe sent off her application, and tomorrow she has her first interview with NASA. If she gets it right, it's the first phase of a long and grueling selection process. If she gets it wrong, she loses a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to fly into space. With help from her husband Steve, she rehearses by taping her presentation.
It's easy to chronicle military, political, and economic history, but social history is harder. I mean, a lot of Americans feel that the space program doesn't belong to them. And I would like to make them feel that it does. I want to bring back my perceptions of what an ordinary person sees from the shuttle. Okay, cut there. These clothes are not right.
Well, I thought that was good.
What do you think of this? Sweetie?
Yeah, I like that. I liked what you had on before.
I don't know. What about this? You like this? How about this?
Huh? That's good.
It's not right. We have to do it again.
I thought it was good. Hey.
Hey. Hey, there's a Zoom.
Dave, can you bring up the blue dress?
Huh?
The blue dress?
Yeah.
Krista gets it exactly right. She makes it through to the next round. Inspired by the pioneering women of American history, she told the judges that she too plans to keep a journal of her journey in space. Out of 11,500 applicants, Krista is now only one of 114. She is on her way to space. The shuttle is the most complex machine ever built. But even NASA admits its design was compromised. NASA needed a successor to the Apollo program, a machine that was more flexible and cheaper. The Apollo program cost $25 billion, the equivalent of $135 billion today. About $11 billion per